You gotta cry, rain, tears of pain, pound the floor and scream his name, cause we're still worth saving. Can't go on like this and live like this, we can't love like this. We gotta give this world back to God. Have you lost the love? Do you feel like giving up? Has your heart been broken? Are your kids okay? Will they come home safe? Do you lie there hoping? You can make a wish. You can knock on wood. Oh, it won't do no good. You gotta get down on your knees, believe, fold your hands and beg and plead. Gotta keep on praying. You gotta cry, rain, tears of pain, pound the floor and scream his name, cause we're still worth saving. And live like this, we can't love like this. We gotta give this world back to God. You gotta get down on your knees, believe, fold your hands and beg and plead. Keep on. We're still worth saving. Can't go on like this and live like this. We can't love like this. You can't hope the best, make a wish. The only answer is we give this world back to God.
You know I shackles and chains. I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back. I'll never be the same. Oh, Lord, my hope is in Jesus. There's a kind of thing, y'all, that just breaks a man, breaks him down to his knees. I've been broken more than a time or two. Oh, yeah, all an imperium. Show me what it was to be a man, yeah. You know I've been born. You know I've been lost. You know I've been washed by the blood. You know I've been washed by the blood.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars.
I see the stars.
I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
When through the woods and forest glades I wander, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and see the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How
Thank you so much for watching How Great Thou Art. This is our first music video from our new album, Full of Even More Cheer. It's out on November 11th, but you can pre-order a copy today.
We're so excited to be partnered with Walmart as our exclusive retailer. You can go over and get all the pre-orders at walmart.com, and we're also going to be autographing all those pre-orders.
And if you're nowhere near a Walmart, you can always get our album at homefreemusic.com.
Don't forget to subscribe to our channel.
And a big special thanks to all our supporters on Patreon. It's you all who help us make such wonderful videos just like this one. If you don't support us already, please go over and check us out. We can use all the help we can get.
And please keep in touch with us. There's a link below in the details where you can sign up for our newsletter. And also go like us and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat.
Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you on the road.
Till my sins wash away. Can I get a hallelujah? Can I get an amen? Feels like the Holy Ghost running through you when I play the Highway FM.
People, rose of faith and love, and lilies of service and sharing, that all may know the love of Jesus.
What a blessing it is to gather on this beautiful morning today. It's trending a little chilly, but not like it is in some places in the world. So we're thankful, right? We're at 35, 38 degrees today. That's not bad. Welcome visiting with us today. Those of you who are in the balcony online, I'm Pastor Larry McReynolds. This is King of Glory Lutheran Church in Providence, Forge. And we are happy that you're joining with us today. May the Lord bless you as you gather with us today. May the Lord be with you. As we gather on this day today, you all survived Super Bowl Sunday?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Quiet. Okay. Did your team win?
It wasn't
it. It wasn't it. You know, I don't think anybody's team
would
win. You know?
Oh, yes. Dave Aldridge is a very unhappy man.
You know, Dave, definitely, you know, that's good. But our evening service, this is a great segue to that. We have a Sunday evening service now. And so we had a whole bunch of people there for the first service on the 5th of February. And then last night it was just Pete Blair and I. It was just both of us, both, you know, were there. So it was good. So we'll see how the Lord does as he gathers people together. We're a church that when we used to meet only in the evening, we used to always kind of make the service really, 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 really short and then go watch the game. So it's always a lot of fun. May the Lord bless you guys always as you gather. We have a couple of announcements today. I just want to remind you that this week, believe it or not, is Ash Wednesday. We're moving right along, right? So it's Ash Wednesday next this coming Wednesday. And we'll have a 7 o'clock service here at church, a service of the word and prayer. And if you'd like, afterwards, on the way out, we also impose ashes as well, if you'd like. And so I encourage you to be here for that and to begin the Lenten journey. To help you during the season of Lent, there's a booklet in on the welcome table in the back. It's called Man of Sorrows, People of Joy. It's a great devotional that's provided for us by Lutheran Hour Ministries. And it's Jesus' journey to the cross through the eyes of Matthew's gospel. So take a look at that, and feel free to take one. They're on the back table as well. And David, want to say hello and congratulations to your team one.
No,
we didn't. No.
So, you know what? But I know the reason why. Because I didn't come to church.
I was only kidding.
I prayed so much Sunday night.
Good work.
Hail Mary, full of grace at
the end. Maybe that was the problem. Only thing. So if anyone wants, heal the wounds. almost there. So getting back to announcements. Okay, and so again, feel free to take one of those Lenten devotion booklets. You may know some people who might be interested in those as well, and feel free to take another one for them as well. Again, our Sunday evening worship, I mentioned to you, we're off and running with that as well. Keep our confirmands in prayer. We're next Sunday at this very service. On the 26th of February, we'll have Confirmation Sunday, and Hannah Tober, and Libby Knoll, and Mackenzie Loveland, all of whom are driving, by the way, just to let you know how frightening is that, okay? They'll be confirming their faith, sharing their testimonies of faith, and so we look forward to celebrating with them next week. Our starting point class, we started, and we have 3 more sessions, maybe more if there's interest in doing that, but we meet on Thursdays at 7 o'clock, and so if you'd like to join with us, feel free. It's just kind of a basics of Christianity through the Lutheran lens, okay, and kind of explains who we are as a church, and some of why we do some of the things that we do, and who we are in Christ. I think that's about it. We do have in the back just some sign-up sheets. If you're looking for offering envelopes, you have that opportunity. If you're looking to sign up for the meal ministry, that would be a real blessing as well. Shannon Trochuk, as you know, is coordinating our meal ministry. It's really going to be a ministry that will be a helping ministry to families that are going through difficulties and stress, like the Fleischmans, who have not begun that journey yet, except they're still getting the care plan and the treatment plan down. But we know that they're going to need some help along the way. So, Shannon, do you want to mention anything as I talk to you?
Yes. The Fleischmans have a large group of friends that want to support them, and so they came up with the idea of us, their friend group and their church family, to combine efforts. And so there's a woman by the name of Stacy, and she's going to actually start a meal train online. And so I'm just going to be like the liaison from our church to her.
Great.
So if I plan to get an email out to get everybody that wants to participate and help.
Great.
To send me their email address. Or you can,
there's about 5 or 6 people who signed up already.
Yeah, or you can do it back here. And then I'm going to get those names to Stacy so that,
great,
you know.
Great. So thank you very much for doing that. We really appreciate that.
Yeah, and we'll put some more information out. Like Grady, he has a peanut allergy, and you know, of course, not sure. I would imagine that Donald will have some dietary restrictions, but we don't know what they are yet. So I'll let you know. I'll let everybody know.
Thank you so much. We appreciate it. And those kind of things will be helpful. I know coming down the pike, I'm not sure if the need is there at this point, but I know Darlene Reeves is still getting over pneumonia. She's back home, but it's really has taken hold. And so she said as of a couple of days ago that she's really not feeling any better. So, but also not needing food right now. But who knows if the need would arise. So keep her in prayer. And again, we thank you, Janet, for coordinating.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, that's appreciated. We do have a word from Kurt as well. Since we talked to Shannon, we might as well hear from Kurt too. Okay. But Kurt, do you have an update on the building by blessing?
Yeah, so I think everybody's heard Larry kind of start saying prayers for architects, and you can see some looks in people's faces like, what's that all about? Long story short is we had to go out on the market and try to locate a new architect to finish our drawings. When we started the process, we weren't 100% sure that we were going to be able to afford to do a building, right? So we only contracted Fultz and Singh to give us the conceptual drawings and what we've gotten so far. We didn't want to sign a contract for $65,000 or $75,000 if it came down to the fact that we couldn't afford to do it. Anyway, long story short, Fultz and Singh got a little greedy with their second half or their second proposal, so we went out on the market, found another company up in Harrisonburg called Blue Line Architectural. We're going to take all the hard work that we've done so far. Nothing will change. That's just going to get transitioned over to Mike at Blue Line Architects, and he's going to continue our architectural drawings and our mechanical drawings. And right now, we have a congregational meeting set for May 7th, and we will have our firm budget to bring to the congregation on May 7th for approval.
Great. Thank you for all this behind-the-scenes stuff that nobody knows about. Thank you for doing all that and for coordinating it all. And to keep that whole project in prayer as we move forward. It's pretty exciting times, for sure. And the new architect, I'm told, too, has some experience in church design, and so I think that will be a good thing, too. So we look forward to all of that. So thank you very much. Any announcements that you might have today as we begin? Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise today. We thank you for the great blessing that you give us in Christ Jesus. Be with us now as we gather together in this place. We ask, Lord, that you would come to us as we meet you and as you meet us in word and in sacrament. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Peace be with you.
Also with you.
We offer each other a sign of Christ's peace. So we peace the Lord.
How
are
you doing? All right.
Maria came first. Sorry.
I know.
I went to
you.
You
know?
Yeah.
Skies, and the creatures praise the rise.
morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. As we gather to worship today, let us contemplate the humility in which the Lord came into the world. Let us consider our unworthiness for such a great gift and confess before God and one another our need of forgiveness. Together as his people, let us look to Christ who fulfilled the law for us and takes away its condemnation by his death on the cross and resurrection from the grave. We take refuge in God's infinite grace and mercy toward us, his children. With confidence in God's grace, let us confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Hear the good news today for you. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son, Jesus, to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Thanks be to God. Your beloved Son, you foreshadowed our adoption as your children. Make us heirs with Christ of your glory, and bring us to enjoy its fullness through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. So, this group is not here today. And, but Sadie's here. So I'm standing in for Miss Ruth today, okay? But I'm talking not only to you, Sadie, but all of these kids here as well. Because they're all God's children. So, a question for you. What does it mean to be on a mountaintop? When you're on a mountaintop, what is it like being up on the top of a mountain? What do you think? Have you ever been to the top of a mountain?
Mm-hmm.
You have? Okay. Is it like being like everywhere else? Or can you see things that are far away? Can you see special things when you're on top of a mountain?
Mm-hmm.
It seems like you're closer to the sky when you're on top of a mountain sometimes, especially at night. Has anybody ever been on a mountaintop in the middle of the night, like at night times? It seems like you could touch the stars and just kind of spin them around. It's pretty cool. Today, we celebrate a time called Transfiguration Sunday. It's a story about when Jesus went to the mountaintop, Mount Tabor, and he went with three of his buddies, Peter, James, and John, and they had an experience on the mountaintop. They didn't see stars in the sky necessarily, and they weren't wowed by maybe what they could see from being way up high. But you know what they saw when they were up there? They saw Jesus. He was clothed in bright light. He was shining like nobody had ever seen before, because they saw a glimpse of Jesus as God, which is pretty cool. And so that's what today is all about when we gather together on this day. We remember that Jesus went to the mountaintop and he brought his friends with him so that they could see something real special. God does that for you too. He gives us mountaintop times all the time. You know why? Because we don't have to go to a mountaintop to see Jesus. Where is Jesus now? Right here, right? So the Lord is with you, Sadie, and with all the kids who are online today. May the Lord bless you every single day, because Jesus is with you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may go to children's church with an amazing teacher today. We continue with our first reading today. Do we have a reading for today? Maybe not. Okay, thank you.
Everybody's coming up.
Let's do all three readings, okay? That's
what I'm doing. It's like, whose line is it?
Lots of polite people.
First is from, first reading is from Exodus 24, 8 through 18. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven of clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God, and ate and drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain, and wait there, that I may give you the tablets of stone, with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses rose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the Lord covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain, and Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
from 2 Peter 1:16-21. For we do not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. When he received honor and glory from the God Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as a lamp to shining in the dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in our hearts. Knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for the Alleluia. According to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We sing together our hymns.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace, they're yours in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. From the Gospel of Matthew. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John his brother, and he led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. Please be seated. Many of you know that I had the privilege of spending about 10 years as a camp director in upstate New York in the Adirondacks. And so I was privileged to be part of a wonderful ministry, the district's ministry, this Camp Sunrise it was called, and it was a great place. And it was in the mountains, which guys from Long Island, Queens area, you know, it was awesome to be in the mountains. Even though some of my staff who came from Colorado, they would look at the mountains of the Adirondacks and they'd look around and they'd say, where are the mountains? You know, to them, mountains are 50,000 billion feet up, you know, and we got to about where we were was just about 2,200 feet up, okay, which is pretty high if you're a flatlander like me, right? So, but to the kids who were there, that became a mountaintop experience. That became a real exciting time. And we would bring staff on. We would, for about 2 months of the year, we would bring staff from all over the country, about 25 to 30 college kids. And we would train them, CPR, all the life-saving stuff they would need for, you know, suburban and city kids going out into the wilds of the Adirondacks. And it was just an awesome time to get those students together and to become one, become a team together. And the purpose of our gathering was that they would be good vessels so that people would see Jesus through them, which is hard to do when you get college kids all together in one place. So it was about 3 weeks of training so that they would become effective at being sharers of God's glory, of the life of Christ, to create mountaintop experiences. So every year I would have all these wonderful people who would come. I keep in touch with many of them even today. From some of them, I've had to go through a lot of therapy, actually, but only kidding. if you're watching, only joke. It wasn't you. But it was a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. But I did have other people outside of the summer staff who really helped the mountaintop experience become truly mountaintop. And it wouldn't be people that you would think. Okay, one guy we used to help out, I'm just going to name two. We had dozens and dozens of people who were benefactors and helpers. But two particularly. One was a guy named Don Tassone. He was from Brooklyn.
And the only way I can explain Don Tassone to you is how I'm speaking to you now. It was not Don Tassone, not Don Corleone, but it was Don Tassone. And Don was a vibrant guy, and he was in the restaurant business.
I never asked any questions, didn't really care, okay? But Don had a real place in his heart for kids who were needy from Brooklyn, because that's where he was. And I asked him one time, I said, why do you love these kids so much? Because he would give money. He would give, we used to call them camperships, not scholarships. And he would provide 3 weeks of camp to, you know, probably 25, 30 kids during the summer. He would pay for their experience, and sometimes multiple weeks. And he says, I love these kids because those kids were me. I was those kids at one time. And he said, I had to get to a place where I got to meet Jesus. And so I want to help with that. It was awesome. He used to do restaurant equipment. He outfitted our conference center before I came. My predecessor, I said, so give me some things I need to know. He says, you need to know Don Tassone. I said, okay. And he just state-of-the-art stuff he would give. And so we were able to create that mountaintop experience for these kids. It was awesome. There's also another guy, he was not a likely character. He owned a moving company. And his name was Morty Lemkow. And Morty Lemkow was one of those saints of the Lord who, whenever I needed something, whenever I needed support, I never had to ask, because the Lord always knew when I needed something, and the phone would ring. Even before I put a letter out or anything else, I would get a phone call from Morty, and Morty would say, "Hey, lad!" That's what he used to call me. "Hey, lad!" I said, "Hey, Morty, how's it going?" "I'm doing all right. Hey, listen." And he's usually in a truck, you know, so his noise, it was the old bag phones, so it was like really, you know. And he said, I want to tell you, I have a job right up in the Albany area, and, you know, I tithe to you every time I do an upstate job." I said, "Good for you, man. Thank you." Because it was right when I needed it. And he had a way of doing it, not just writing a check, but he would come, and whenever he was in the area, he would stop in, especially in the summertime, to see the kids, to see them at the campfire, to see them hearing God's word, to be with us in our worship times when God's word was imparted. It was awesome. And, you know, God showed his love and light and glory through him in a way he could do it. A mountaintop experience he helped to make. The gospel lesson for today, I was drawn to the first part of that gospel lesson. Take a look at it with me, Matthew chapter 17. Because you talk about the mountaintop experience of all mountaintop experiences, and it's actually probably this scripture is probably where we get the phrase "a mountaintop experience," is this experience with Jesus on the mountain with Peter, James, and John. But it says, "And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves." And I got to thinking, I wonder what happened, like, 6 days earlier. I mean, there's a space of time that goes on. So I got curious, and I looked back in Matthew, and it's interesting to see that this kind of chronologically falls in a very interesting spot. It's before Jesus has gone, obviously, to Jerusalem, but he was on his way. Jesus had his eyes set toward Jerusalem. And I think even from his mountaintop experience, he knew that the next step would be to be in this place for him. And so you go back a little bit further, you go into chapter 16 of Matthew, and you see Jesus having a give and take with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They wanted to see signs. They wanted to see some miracles. They wanted to see some demonstration of Jesus' power. As if, you know, he was just a magician. He was just somebody coming through town. They wanted to kind of prove him to be wrong, but Jesus was the Word made flesh. He was God's truth speaking to them. And here these great scholars couldn't see that, couldn't even hear that. They wanted to see something else, right? And then in chapter 16, verse 13, you don't have this, but it's the story of Peter's great confession of faith. And it says here, "Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?'" Who do people say that I am? You know, because there are so many people who have their ideas. And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter, he says this. He says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." The great confession of faith, upon which that confession of faith is what the church is built upon. People confessing, people who confess Jesus Christ as Lord, that's the entry point. Jesus the Christ, knowing him as Lord and Savior. And Jesus says, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." He's pretty pleased with Peter, no? Then Jesus feels moved to tell his disciples, "You know, following me is going to be a little different. It's going to be a little difficult. And then he goes on to the whole idea of, you know, this is what's going to happen to me. And he shares with them, as he will do many times before he is crucified, he shares plainly with them what he is about. And he says these words. He said, from that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and that he must suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And on the third day, be raised. And Peter, same Peter, by the way, who he just praised. He said, your confession was the best ever. This is amazing. You, God has told you this. My Father in heaven has told you this. That very same Peter says to him, no, Lord, far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. Now, on the one hand, Jesus in the flesh might have found that appealing. Like, oh, yeah, maybe he's right. Because I know what's ahead for me. I know it's going to be pain and suffering ahead for me. I know it's going to be death on a cross. It's going to happen. But then, Jesus being fully God, of course, doesn't succumb to that, however tempting that might be. And he utters these words to Peter. Do you know what he says to Peter now? He says, get behind me, Satan. The very same guy who just a couple of days before he was lauding because of his confession of faith, saying, This upon this rock I'm going to build my church. Now, the very same Jesus is telling that very same person, get behind me, Satan. You're a hindrance to me. And then he goes on and he starts to talk to them in the course of these couple of days before the event. He starts to say that, hey, you know, if you're really going to follow me, you're going to have to take up your cross and follow me. Life is going to be different. It's going to look different for you. And now we get to the mountaintop. So he's gone through some history with these guys, especially. And then it says, and after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up on a high mountain. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with them. And then Peter says these words, always Peter, right? He says these words, Lord, it is good that we're here. It's really great for you, Lord, that we're here, because you know what? We are going to make three tents. We're going to put up three tents so we can worship Elijah, and we can worship Moses, and we can give honor to you as well. You know, and Jesus in his glory. We can't even imagine what that's like. I mean, I'm in a white robe right now, you know, but I'm not nearly as glorious as Jesus was. Jesus shone like with the brilliance of the light of creation. God in the flesh now manifested in his full divinity. People in the Old Testament would go like this because they'd be afraid to even look at the holiness of God. But here is Peter and James and John witnessing this, beholding Jesus as he is, fully God in their midst. And then as he was still speaking, I love that. He's so excited, right? Oh yeah, Moses and Elijah, they're here. We love them. We love these two dudes. We've been waiting for these people. They're heroes of the faith. And you too, Jesus. And then it says that the cloud descended while he was still speaking. A bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. And the next three words are really important. It said, the Lord God says, listen to him. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. Because in him you're going to get the fullness of life. I think that's pretty powerful stuff as we look at it. And then it says, when the disciples heard this, they fell on their knees and they were terrified. But Jesus touched them and said, rise and have no fear. And then when they lifted up their eyes, they only saw Jesus. And then it says that Jesus traveled with them down the mountain as well. From that glorious appearing, then back down into regular life. So you have this beautiful arc, right, of Jesus getting to know his disciples and them getting it and knowing it and understanding, but then not falling in and falling away. Then they're at the mountaintop, seeing Jesus in his fullness and still not getting it fully, but Jesus loving them. Rise. Don't be afraid. He doesn't say, you idiots. He doesn't say that to them. He just says, rise and don't be afraid. And he leads them down the mountain to the other side. Now, waiting for him on the other side of that mountain is the journey to the cross. We all know how that turned out. Those same disciples who saw Jesus for who he was, these three especially, glimpsed the glory of God, Jesus in his full manifestation of God's glory. And still, and I'm going to pick on Peter because he's so easy, he denies Jesus at the end. James and John, and John was there, but only because he was told to be there. James disappears. I think, why is the story here for us? Well, I think because we are Peter, James, and John. We have history every single day with the Lord, don't we? He walks with us. We walk with him. We sin. We don't. We repent. We're forgiven. We sin. We repent. We confess and we're forgiven. We sin. And we can over and over and over again, this happens because of our humanity. It's because we do sin well, right? But Jesus does love well. He does it the best. And so we see in this the power of God working even through us. When we realize that we have the opportunity to not only walk side by side with Jesus, but Jesus has chosen on this side of the mountain, on this side of the cross, on this side of the resurrection, on this side of Pentecost, to have the Holy Spirit dwell in us, to have his Spirit actually reside with us, to accompany us everywhere as God. That's how much he loves you. He doesn't extricate himself when you do something wrong. He doesn't go far away. Really, he's still there. That is an amazing act of love by the Creator of heaven and earth, who sent his son Jesus to die for you and for me when we didn't really deserve it at all. But you know what? We now have new life. And I think it's interesting when you see in 2 Peter, that 2 Peter text, here we have Peter again, right? And he's sharing this, and he goes, "For we do not follow cleverly devised myths that we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. We saw Jesus," is what he's saying. "We saw him off in his fullness and in his power." And then he goes on, and he talks about, in verse 21, "For no prophecy, no word, no spoken word, no word from the Lord was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." God so intimately involved the Word of God for us and with us, helping us and encouraging us. Jesus brings James and Peter and John to the mountaintop, and as he travels down the mountain with them into the rest of their lives, he moves with them to his cross. They don't always understand him, but he loves them still the same. They often forget who he is, and yet he loves them still the same. They leave him to die a horrible death on the cross at Calvary, and yet he loves them still the same and dies for them that they might live, dies for them that they might know forgiveness, dies for them that they might know new life, because he loves them and he loves you, and he loves me. No matter how many times we fall short, he loves you. Never doubt that. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul says these words, because it's hard being a Christian. He found that out. Peter, James, and John found that out. We find that out as we go through our lives, right? It's hard being a Christian in the world today. It's hard holding up and standing firm for Jesus. It's hard to be a people who are solid in the Word, where the Word is the most central and most important thing for us to know the truth. And that truth sets us free because that word is Christ Jesus. And yet the world crowds around us, right, and gives us other information and says, hey, look here, look here. God always directs us back to his word of truth and promise, his word that is rock for us. Paul knew this, and he writes these words. He says of the church, who were persecuted and who were having difficulties, he said, we are hard-pressed on every side. But he says we're not crushed, right? We're persecuted, but not abandoned. We're struck down, but not destroyed. And he says this, and this is important. He says, we always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body, in us. You and I were baptized into the death and the resurrection of Christ Jesus. We carry around in us the very light of Christ. Same glory that was at the mountaintop, they had to go and meet. That same glory comes to us in the Word of God, in the sacrament that we share, God's gift to us of word and sacrament, his very presence in our body as we go through life's journey. Be encouraged by that. Be encouraged by that word that changes us, that shapes us, that makes us like Adon Tasson, that makes us like even a Morty Lemkow. Always willing to serve, always willing to share the light of Christ, always willing to share that mountaintop experience with others. May that be us in this time, in this place, for the world around us. The last verse of the hymn that we just sang a few minutes ago, I'm going to close with this as kind of our prayer. Lord, transfigure our perception with the purest light that shines, and recast our life's intentions to the shape of your designs, till we seek no other glory than what lies past Calvary's hill, and our living, and our dying, and our rising by your will. Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for leading us to the mountaintop, where the cross of Christ is for us, and where the empty tomb is for us. We thank you, Lord, for leading us to the mountaintop when we gather for worship to hear your word and to receive you in the sacrament, the Lord's Supper. Father, you are with us. You will never abandon us, leave us, or forsake us. We have, too, beheld your glory. And so, Father, help us to live in that light, in that promise, in that life that is ours in Christ Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen. We rise as God's people of faith, and we speak the words of the Nicene Creed, found on page 5.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made,
who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man. He was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God.
And he will come again with the glory to judge both the living and the dead,
whose kingdom will not have an end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church.
I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins,
and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated as we sing our next song. Receive our grateful thanks today and receive these offerings of our time, of our talent, and of our treasure, Lord, that your work through us might continue and flourish, that all people might know the love of your Son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. 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 As we gather today for prayer, again, we remember a number of people in our church community. We remember the Fleischmanns. Just as a word as well, too, there's a sign-up sheet in the back for Meals for the Fleischmanns, if you'd like to put your name and information on there. We remember not only Donald, but also Christy and the kids as well. We We also remember Kathy Cheater, Gina Tolbert's mom, who was ill and hospitalized. We continue to remember our brother Phil as he continues to recover from his medical situation. We also pray in a very special way for President Carter, I guess, who's in hospice care, from what I understand, this morning. And we pray for him and for his wife. He's 98 years old.
Wow.
75 years married, I think. That's a lot of years. shame on you. But we pray for them as well. We also pray for those who are suffering loss in Turkey and in Syria. I guess the death toll is up to about 37,000-38,000 people who lost their lives. We pray for the church as it works in that area and for all who are helping. We also pray in a very special way for our brothers and sisters in Ohio with that train derailment as well, that all that would be rectified and that they would be healed as well. To rise for prayer. Heavenly Father, you revealed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son Jesus on that mountaintop. And he tabernacled among us in the flesh. Open our eyes that by faith you would see him continuing to dwell with us each day. We are his very tabernacles now as we live our lives by his Spirit. Help us truly listen to him and his word as he forgives and preserves us as his people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you alone establish all authority on earth. Bless those entrusted with authority, especially our president, our governor, our county minister, all who hold office. Lead them to serve with integrity and honor for the well-being of all. Grant that all division, conflict, and strife would give way to unity, peace, and quietness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for those who have been affected by the earthquake activity in Turkey and Syria, as well as those who suffered loss in that derailment in Ohio. There's so many things that are unknown in both of those situations. So, Father, we pray that you would provide for all of those people, that you would guard and guide those who are going into the area to bring help and comfort. Be with your church as they share the life and healing love of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we pray for all who serve in law enforcement, especially Sheriff Joe and Deputy Heath, and all who serve in the New Kent Department, as well as all departments throughout the country. We also pray for judges and all who serve in the court system to bring justice. We also pray, Father, for firefighters, EMS workers, doctors, nurses, medical teams, all of them, Lord, every one of them, serve selflessly that we might be able to live our lives in peace and in safety. And so be with them all, Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide and protect the men and women who defend our freedom and liberty in the military, both here and abroad, and lift up especially our brother Dylan as he continues to serve. Be with all military families as well. Keep them and sustain them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we pray for those who we love, our family, our friends, our neighbors, all who are in need of prayer today. And we lift their names to you now in this place. Father, you know all of these people, those we've spoken out loud, those in our hearts, those on our prayer guide, and we pray, Father, that you would meet them at their greatest need, and that you would deliver to them your peace, that you would deliver to them your healing, that you would restore and renew, and that you would give love and hope and your joy in the midst of their life journey. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Father, we continue as a church to continue to place our trust in you as we build by faith, to increase and expand ministries and to build our first permanent home. Lord, continue to guide us. We thank you, Lord, that over the last week or so, you provided for us in the form of an architect who will work with us. Father, let your will be done as we continue to trust in you, trusting that you, Lord, can do far more abundantly than all that we can ever ask or think. And we do this, Lord, so that all people would know the love of your Son, Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
May your light, Lord, shine on us and through us and in us in our daily lives. Give us confidence, Lord, in your word that we would live without fear. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We pause to share this holy meal together, because the Lord Jesus, when he commanded his disciples, his church, to do this, he knew that it was here that we would catch a glimpse of his glory when he comes to watch in us in his very flesh and blood, with us now, and taking him with us in life's journey. And so as we gather around this meal today, we come with faith to receive his word. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Father, ever-living God. As the glory of your presence once filled your ancient temple, so in the incarnation of your Son Jesus, you made known and manifest the fullness of your glory in human flesh. We give you thanks that in this most holy supper you reveal your glory to us once again. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and to drink his blood, so that we may one day behold your glory face to face. Now with angels and archangels and with the whole company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and saying,
Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave the cup to his disciples and said, Take this, all of you, and drink of it. This is the cup of my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Amen. Please be seated. Can I have a
communion assistant? Sure. I don't do the words.
Thank you. may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus, his true presence with you, may it keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the prayer of thanks. Lord Jesus, your true presence has come to each of us in your word and promises, and we give you thanks and praise. We pray that we might now go out into the world as your people, your church, proclaiming your love.
Strengthen us as your people, connected to you by your Spirit, that we may grow in faith and love to share the good news of Jesus as we live in him. Amen.
God's people proclaim
and all that we ask is thank you, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
As we now leave the mountaintop into the world in which we live, go with these words that you might receive hope and encouragement by this blessing. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Amen. We sing together our closing hymn.
Sorry, here's where I turn off the audio.